open up our Bibles to Luke 21:36. And again, I love my pastor's wife. I love our leadership. I thank you for this opportunity. I don't take it lightly. I kept telling everyone, I feel like I'm pregnant. Like, I feel like I've just been carrying this word, like, all month, and I just want to deliver it tonight. And, like, let's see what it comes into existence from it. Amen? Luke 21:36 reads, "Watch, therefore, and pray always that you may be counted worthy to escape all the things that will come to pass and stand before the Son of Man." And we see here in Scripture that Jesus repeatedly kept warning his disciples during the latter part of his ministry to stay alert and be ready for his return. And we can ask ourselves, what does that mean? That we have to know the exact time when God's coming so we can say our sinner prayer right before? No, because we don't know when God's coming. But I believe this scripture means that we got to live with a faithful attentiveness, an expectation and hope for Jesus' return, that he stands near us, that he's always with us, ladies, and that he can come back at any moment. And this evening, I want to speak to the leaders. I want to speak to the mothers. I want to speak to the daughters and the wives of Victory Outreach San Diego. And tonight, my title is, "You Must Get Up." And I got this title because a few weeks ago, I decided I wanted to sleep in. You know, I usually work Saturdays. I go and volunteer my time at a center for children. But this particular Saturday, I was tired. I had worked like 50 hours, and I'm like, no, I deserve a day off. I'm going to sleep in. I don't care. I'm going to call in. Sorry, Kat, today. And so that morning, my husband wasn't there, and I was just so tired. I remember being like almost like in a comatose state, like where you hear what's going around, but you like can't get up. You know those Sunday afternoon naps where you're like, I'm going to just sleep for 30 minutes, and you're like, oh, my gosh, I feel like a truck hit me. I felt like that. But what I also recognize that when I decided to sleep in that morning and my husband wasn't there, I felt my house really cold. I felt just a lot of noise going around, and I didn't feel my son next to me. So I was like, oh my goodness, you know, but I'm still sleeping, you know, because I'm so tired. And I'm like, okay. And then I heard the TV on. So then my mind's going like, how did he turn the TV on? That's dangerous. And then I smelled like a dirty diaper somewhere. So I'm like, oh my goodness, my kid is running around. But there I still lay there, just so tired. I'm like, I deserve a day off to sleep in. And the next thing I noticed as I try to fall back to sleep, I heard my son saying, "Mama, get up, Mama, I'm hungry. Mama, get up." And something in me while I was preparing this message kept ringing, that the mothers and the daughters of this house, that we need to rise, that no more complacency can take place, that what God wants to do in our church, we as the mothers and the daughters of this house, we need to take our place. We need to rise. Don't disqualify yourselves. You're like, well, I'm a single mother. Amen. We need you, single mother. You have a place in this ministry. This ministry was designed with each and every one of us in mind. Do you know that, ladies? We're so special. Yes. You know, when people try to compare us and they get frustrated because they church hop and they go, well, it's not like this and it's not like that. Well, it's not supposed to be like that, ladies. Yes. We have a special calling on our life. We have an anointing, yes, on our worship, on our speakers. So if you're trying to come in here with, yeah, a different church mentality or different theology and try to bring it in here, you're going to be frustrated. Yeah. Because the standards and principles were given by God. They weren't man created, but they gave it to our leaders and to our visionary leaders and to our elders and to Pastor Sunny and Sister Julian. We have to hold that with respect and honor, amen? Amen. When a mama arises, there is an anointing that comes upon us, ladies. How many of us know, like Sister Nikki was saying earlier, like we know when mama's up. We hear when mom gets home, we hear the keys hit the cabinet table, we hear our heels walking in, and it's kind of like, oh shoot, stop what you're doing, mom's here, you know? Like, you change, we're atmosphere changers, you know? Like, we don't walk in a room and they're just like, oh hey, what's up? We walk in, it's like, oh yeah, I did the laundry, you know? Oh hey, I have to do this, or hey babe, you know, I gotta go here and there, and right away, right? Like this posture comes up, like this respect comes up, right? when mama walks in the room. And that's the same thing, the same anointing in our spiritual life, that when we arise, ladies, daughters, when you arise, something awakens in you. Amen. Our capacity, ladies, is to carry. You know, we know how to birth a child. 9 long, hard months. You know, we gain a lot of weight. I won't say how much weight, but we gain. No one tells you about this, okay? I'm a first-time mom, and I learned a lot, but I'm grateful for my son, but it's a process, right? And a lot of us, we carry. We carry our kids. We carry our ministry. We carry our marriage. But some of us, we carry the wrong thing. Some of us, we carry bitterness. And some of us, we carry unforgiveness. Some of us, we carry pride. Some of us, we carry things that happened to us as a child, and you begin to blow up. It's like the people who have liver disease, and their liver stops working, and their stomach blows up because they can't get the toxins out. So it just increases their stomach. And tonight, ladies, some of us, we walk around like that with a bloated stomach. And we wonder why we can't get a breakthrough. And we wonder why, oh, this is just another countdown. Oh, it's just another convention. Nothing new, nothing fresh. Because we're walking around with this dead weight. We're walking around with this disease that's cutting the life flow out of us. That's cutting what God is trying to do within our spiritual life. That the inner man can't awaken. That seed that God's giving you is so down, pressed down because of all the weight of the world has taken over. And I believe tonight God wants to deliver that. I believe that some of us, we walk around because we're physically sick. And I couldn't sleep this week. I kept waking up like 3 a.m., 2 a.m. And yeah, some of it is because I was nervous, but I just kept seeing your faces. And I was just like, God, what do you want to do in these countdowns? I don't want it to just be another night where we gather together and we feel good. And then we go back and do the same thing. But I believe that God wants to deliver us tonight of things that have been holding us down too long. That God has given something inside of us that needs to awaken a passion, a gift, a ministry that needs to be birthed into existence. Amen. I believe God is declaring us as women to rise. This church, ladies, does not need you to play small. This world does not need you to play small. We all have something to give. We all have a seed inside of us, a passion. Something has been put in each and every one of us. A seed that is waiting to be watered, waiting to be nurtured, waiting to be developed and to birth into existence. When I first came here, I was all about school. I loved the Lord, but like my focus was school, right? And I'm gonna be transparent. At first I felt like, man, how am I gonna play a part in this ministry? You know, I don't really have anything to offer. I can't sing, but I love to worship, but I cannot sing, but I'm a worshiper at heart, amen? And I felt like I couldn't preach when I was little. I'm left-handed, so I used to write backwards. It was really hard for me. Education was really hard for me, that my parents had to take me out of regular school and put me into a private school to invest, and I thank God for that. But so I was really complex about, like, speaking. I had, like, a speech impediment, and so I just felt like I had nothing to offer, and all I had was just my studies. And then God told me one day, don't minimize the gift that I gave you. And ladies, tonight, sometimes we minimize the gift that it's not enough. Like, who am I? I don't have anything. I'm uneducated. I don't have all these giftings. I have a past. Well, that's why this ministry was for you, because yes, your past is your testimony. And through that testimony, I believe there's a deliverance through it. I believe that someone is out there on the street waiting to hear that, hey, I used to be out on that street corner. Hey, I used to be all doped up. Hey, I used to be in Las Colinas, but now I stand here as a worship leader. Now I stand here ushering in God's presence, amen? Someone needs to hear it. Don't minimize what God has given you. And if it's hospitality, ladies, you set the table like a king. Look at tonight. It's beautiful. We do everything with such excellence. And some ladies feel like, well, I don't really have anything to offer, but I have an extra room, my home. Well, we've been seeing that this year so many men and women have been coming to our church wanting to be fed, wanting to grow. And we need women of this house to rise up and say, hey, I'm available. Just like the Shunammite woman, she was available and she gave out of her abundance. She knew the prophet was coming. Her pastor didn't have to go tell her, hey, sister, can you open up your house? No, she was ready. Amen. Do we have any ready women tonight that are saying, hey, you don't have to tell me, pastor. I'm right here. I'm ready. I know the harvest is coming. And if it's a pillar that God's called you to be in this ministry, you be that cornerstone, ladies. Yes. This world is a first-class ministry, and we know anything first-class doesn't come cheap. Yeah. Amen? And if it's the word of God, use that insight and depth that God's given you. Amen. Don't hold back. Amen. This church, we need you to rise, ladies. If God's given you the word and you could preach it, you preach it, ladies. If God's given you the word to teach it, you teach it. There is a place. There is room for here. We have family life flow. We have Bible encounter. We have life groups. We have sectionals rising up. There's no excuses. And most importantly, we need to live out the gospel. And tonight, I want to take a look at two influential women that really stuck out to me in the Bible, and that's Deborah and Jael. And what I love about these two women is how they just served God with their life and not just with their lips. They weren't lip service, amen? That they would say yes, yes in front of their leaders, or yes, I'll open up my home, or yes, I'll answer the call, but their actions spoke different. No, these women strive to be everything that God called them to be, to not just sit around while the enemy ran rapid in their house, but they rose to the occasion. If we can open up our Bibles to Judges 4 through 4 or 5, chapter 4, verse 5, sorry. And it reads, Now Deborah, a prophet, the wife of Lepidot, was leading Israel at the time. And she held court under the palm of Deborah between Ramah and Bethel in the hill country of Ephraim. And the Israelites went up to have their disputes decided. She sent forth Barak, the son of Abnon from Kedesh in Naphtali, and said to him, The Lord, the God of Israel, commands you, go take with you 10,000 men of Naphtali and Zebulun and lead them up to Mount Tabor. And I will lead Sisera, the commander of Jabin's army, with his chariots and his troops to the Kishon River and give him into your hands. Barak said to her, If you go with me, I will go. But if you don't go with me, I will not go. And Deborah responded, Certainly I will go with you. But because of the course you are taking, the honor will not be yours. For the Lord will deliver Sisera into the hands of a woman. So Deborah went with Barak to Kedesh. There Barak summoned the troops. 10,000 men went up under his command, and Deborah also went up with them. And we read that Deborah is a prophetess. She's not just, you know, just an ordinary woman, but she was a woman that held a place of honor. She was a judge of her time. And we see that Deborah, she knew the Lord and that the Lord spoke to her. But you see how much respect she had, because when Deborah rose up, that meant it was time for war. All she had to do was summon Barak. And she had that spiritual authority, that all she had to do was send forth word out, and that the troops got ready. And when she gave command, it was time to go to war. And ladies, I want you to look to see how much spiritual authority that we have, that if we can rise up in our home, in our city, and in our church, and see that the spiritual authority that we possess, that when God speaks to us, when God drops something in our spirit, and when we're activated, that means it's time for war, ladies. We're getting ready to take back our family, our church, our city, not with the passive spirit, ladies. I know that some of us, we could be real passive. But I believe that God wants to bring out an aggressive spirit among us. That we say no more. No more complacency. No more pettiness. No more unforgiveness. No more sin in this house. Amen? Amen. Deborah, like I mentioned, was the fourth judge of her time. And what I love about Deborah is she wore this, I don't want to say title, but this responsibility with such humility and authority. Deborah knew that it was time for war, And she didn't decrease back when they said, we'll go to war, but are you going to join us? She wasn't like, oh, no, 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 I sit here under the palm tree and you come to me. No, 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 she stepped forward with faith. She stepped forward Amen. With the victorious spirit and saying, yes, I will join you.
Amen.
And ladies, we need to have that kind of spirit. We need to have that spirit that says when we're getting called out that we're like, oh, no, I'm just here to delegate. I'm just here to, you know, I see that need. Hopefully someone can go talk to those people or what's going on with the parking or kids gangs in need. There's no teachers. Yes, you see that need because God is putting it in your heart for you to rise up, ladies. Amen. And sometimes it's just taking that step of faith. Our part is just going. I know earlier they asked, was it hard getting here tonight? And sometimes the hardest part is just showing up, right?
Yeah.
Like the devil will stop you, will put every detour in front of you to get you not to be here, but you're here, you arrived, so let's make the best of it, amen?
Yeah.
God equips us to be what we need to be at the assignment at hand. In chapter 5 of Judges, we learn that God makes it rain so much that the river overflows into the valley and it turns into mud. So we see Jabin's army, 900 chariots coming after Barak and his troops. And all of a sudden, this big, gigantic mudslide comes and they get stuck. And we see that God, it was a God set up. It was God. He just told them to go and he would meet them there. And God set that whole thing up that they were... Those 900 chariots couldn't move, and they fell by the edge of the sword. And this is where we get introduced to Sisera and Jael. Sisera fled to the tent of Jael, and this is what I love about Jael. Jael was just, you know, we could say a housewife. She was just a consistent mom at home, a homemaker. She was just there, you know, probably stirring some pancakes in the morning for her kids. And then all of a sudden, she sees the enemy coming. And what I love about Jael, she wasn't confused. You know, sometimes we let things in our lives come in our lives that we don't know that's the enemy. And we think, oh, maybe this is God. Oh, maybe this is my man of God, you know, my Boaz. And we allow the enemy to come in because we're confused. You know, we haven't spent time with the Lord. We're not alert. But Jael, oh, no, she wasn't mistaken. She knew her enemy. She knew he was coming. And she was ready for him. She greeted him. She welcomed him in. She made him think, I'm on your side. Come in. I'll cover you. Don't worry. I'm not going to tell anyone you're here. He offered. He asked for some water, and she gave him milk. You know, she had a she set the table for a king, right? She didn't give him no water, some tap water. She gave him some milk, organic. And while the enemy thought, oh, okay, she's on my side, he fell asleep. He let his guard down. You know, he thought, oh, she's not going to tell anyone. She's not going to go out, you know. I'm good. But, oh, little did he know who Jael was, amen? Well, the enemy slept right in front of her. She picked up the very thing that she used every day, the hammer and the peg. Every day, the very tools that God equipped her with in her occupation, she was a tent builder. And the very tools that God had placed around her every single day was the very tools that were going to kill the enemy in this evening, ladies. I want to let you know the very thing that God has given you. If he's given you a voice, if he's given you the word, if he's given you those children, amen, use it every day. Develop it. Disciple those kids. You don't know who you're raising, amen. You don't know who you're raising. I remember my mom would always tell me this story. That the teacher, she spoke a powerful story that she would teach Pastor Sonny Jr. And she said, I never know who I was teaching, but I would give my best. And you teachers downstairs, you nursery workers, don't minimize the task that God has placed you. You don't know the giant you're raising. You don't know that giant slayer that you're breeding. So when you have that month that I have to go work down there, we have three services now, oh my gosh, we have to be back at 4. Don't minimize it, lady. See it as an opportunity that, man, I'm investing into this next generation, amen? And this story reassures us that we can win the battle with whatever we come to God with because he always makes up the difference. And Jael, what I love about Jael is she was the unexpected hero in the story. She was a Canaanite woman. She belonged to, Jabin's tribe. You know, she could have been shunned for what she did. And some of you ladies tonight, you're the unexpected hero in your family, and you don't even know it yet.
Yes.
People talked about you. People counted you out. You were less than. You know, you always thought, oh, I'll never be nothing. I'm just coming to church because, you know, that's what they say to do. But no, you have a purpose behind you. You have a seed, something in you that has been planted in you that's drawn you here to our church. It's not by accident, ladies. You are not here by accident. And God is developing the hero inside of you because you are going to deliver your family from bondage. You're going to deliver that drug addiction that has been generation after generation. And you're going to arise, lady, because you are the JLs of your family. Tonight, I believe that God wants to wake up a giant inside of you. Do you believe that, ladies? No, really, do you believe that with everything in you, that there is something more in you, that you know this is not all you've been created for, that God has input and deposited so much stuff that wants to come out, but are you ready? JL's occupation in life was just to put up tents. You know, she didn't have a platform. She just lived in the shadows. She had no special gifting. But God found her living in that desert. And he knew he could use her because she was faithful. And he had a plan for her to save a nation. JL was a specialist in her field. She worked her field. And when the time came for the call to go out that the enemy was coming, she was activated. She was ready. But this didn't happen overnight, ladies. This came from years of preparation. You know, we talked about earlier how she used the very thing that she used every day. They said it was kind of like a spatula. You know, we make our eggs every morning. We make our French toast. The very tools that God equipped her with, is that's how she killed the enemy. But what I love about JL was her tools weren't rusty. You know, she didn't need to pull out a manual saying, how do I do this, you know? What do I do? The enemy's right here. Hold on, let me call my leader. Hold on. Leader, hey, the enemy's at my door. What do I do? No, ladies, these are nights like this that you've been equipped. You have that peg and you have that hammer. Use it every single day. When you wake up, you set the pace in your house. You set that atmosphere and say, devil, you have no place here. Satan, that sickness is gone, and you set that atmosphere. You use the very tools. If it's your voice, then worship. Worship not only on the stage, but off the stage. Worship in your job. If it's evangelism, go out. Be that marketplace minister. Use the very tools that God has given you. She wasn't rusty. She knew the target. She wasn't confused of who was in her house. She knew that was the enemy, and she knew she had to defeat him. She didn't call her neighbor over. She didn't call the troops like, hey, God, hey, men of God, the enemy's in my house. Can you come and save me? No, she was a warrior. She was equipped. She had the very tool she needed for the assignment at hand to defeat the enemy. Amen? Because of her obedience, because of our obedience, ladies, we can impact a nation. Gang girls, because of your obedience, because of your purity, because that there's so much purpose behind that purity, you could save a generation. Amen? Deborah had wisdom and courage, and God placed her where he was going to use her. Sometimes, you know, we get raised up in our job, you know, and we get placed in these great, amazing jobs, and, you know, we become managers, and God really did a new work in your life, and we're grateful. I'm grateful. I know I'm grateful for my job because it's a resource to help me to build the house of God, and I never forget that, ladies. And some of you guys have been placed in high authority. You guys are business owners, but I want you to know it's for a purpose. It's not for you to just build that fat account, amen. It's not for you to be just debt-free, because I'm all about that. But I know my purpose, and I'm reminded why I went to school, why God equipped me, why God has placed me in the job he has, because we are in a mountain of influence. And you guys got to recognize that. Recognize the things that are in front of you, the people that you're leading every day, the jobs, who you're encountering every single day. Yes, you may just be writing a check, but what is that check going to do? Ladies, understand what God has equipped you with, where God has placed you. Jael was a woman of conviction and strength, and God used her right where she was. Jael got God's attention not for her special talent. You know, she wasn't a prophetess. She wasn't, you know, a singer. She wasn't a preacher. But she was just a woman of consistency and conviction. And do we have any women like that tonight in the house of God? You may say, you know what, I don't have a lot to offer, but I can offer my life. I'm a woman of conviction. You can count on me. She didn't negotiate with the enemy. God knew where to find Jael because she was consistent. Meant she never left her post. She never left her assignment. She was a woman who can be counted on. And I ask you tonight, are you a woman who can be counted on? Can your family count on you, ladies? Are we going to sleep in while the enemy runs rapid in our house? She showed up and she let God do the rest. And sometimes, ladies, like I mentioned earlier, some of our biggest challenge is just showing up. And what I love about Jael and Deborah is they had no sympathy for sin. They knew the king wasn't happy, so it had to go. And ladies, tonight, I believe that you got to just get it in your spirit and just say, no more, no more. Oh, I've carried this kid too long. No more is sin going to be in my house. You know what? I see my disciple going off a little bit. I don't like what she's doing. No more am I just going to sit down and watch her go down that path, but I'm going to rise to the occasion and the responsibility that God has given me to speak up. These women weren't afraid to identify the things that were not the will of God, and they boldly remove it from their household and the church. Jael, she was anointed, she was chosen, she was favored, and she was equipped physically and spiritually. While Deborah was a prophet who was respected among many, a judge is a place of authority, and I'm sure it took many years of studying the law, of proving herself worthy of this responsibility. She was so in tune with the voice of God and obeyed his commands. And in return, God gave her favor among the people because he knew the God she served. And ladies, respect is such a big thing. I know sometimes we're like, oh, they don't show me respect. I'm not going to give them respect. No, ladies, we are ladies. We are first-class ladies, right? Were any first-class ladies here tonight? Let me tell you this. When you lose that respect in your life, when you lose that respect among the people, you lose that authority that God has given you. And a woman who's going to be in the front lines of God's army must be respectable. No power is achieved through a self-proclamation in God's kingdom. It comes through being peaceable. It comes through being faithful. It comes through having that spirit like, Lord, use me. I may not be perfect, but God, I'm going to honor those around me. I'm going to respect those that come around me. And yes, I may not always agree, but Lord, you're using that leader. You're using that pastor for a reason, God. Let me be open. Deborah defended her church, her family, and her city. And she did it respectfully, showing honor to her leadership and the authority around her. And I just want to quickly read Timothy 3, 2 through 12. It's a little long, but I'm going to read it really quick. Now the overseer is to be above reproach, faithful to his wife, temperate, self-controlled, respectful, hospitable, able to teach, not given to drunkenness, not violent, but gentle, not quarrelsome, but not a lover of money. He must manage his own family well and see that his children obey him. He must do so in a manner worth of full respect. He must not be a recent convert, or he may not become conceited and fall under the same judgment as the devil. He must also have a good reputation with outsiders so that he will not fall into disgrace and into the devil's trap. He is the same way deacons are to be worthy of respect, sincere, not indulging in wine, not pursuing dishonest gain. They must keep hold of deep truths of faith with a clear conscience. They must be first tested, and then if there's nothing against them, let them serve as deacons. And in the same way, the women are to be worthy of respect, not malice talkers, but temperate, trustworthy in everything they do. And this was Paul. He was helping his disciple out, Timothy, and he was giving him outline of requirements of what the church should be, some non-negotiables that shouldn't have taken place in the church. And ladies, tonight, if we want to be used by God, and most importantly, if we want to be anointed and appointed by God, we have to live above the reproach. We can't get involved in civilian affairs. Last week, you know, we saw a horrible tragedy take place in Florida, and that really shook me as a mother, as a student. You know, I was really shooken up by that, and I just kept watching the news, and I was just like, that's all I talked about, until, like, thank God for our husbands, right? My husband's like, okay, snap out of it, Brianna. What are you going to do, though? Like, are you just going to sit there and be all emotional about it, or what are you going to do? What could we do as a city? What could we do as a nation? We could pray for the leaders. We could rise every morning and making sure that we're covering our children, covering our jobs, covering those courthouses. Don't just sit there, complacent woman, and just be so stressed out and moved by what the media is portraying. And that happened to me. I was like, so that's all I talked about for, like, I'm sure some of you guys were like that too. Like, it really shook us. It really shook our nation. But ladies, we can't be emotional about it. What we could do as mothers, as educators, as Christian women, as daughters of this house is to rise in prayer, to rise to be more aware that when we walk in a room that we're not so busy mission-minded, we're not seeing the hurting around us, we're not seeing the depressed, we're not seeing the oppression that's in front of us because we're so busy. But that when we walk in a room that we're like, Lord, give us your eyes to see the need. Lord, give us your ears to hear the cry. Yes. I pray for that spirit now. I didn't have it before. I pray that we're more awakened, ladies, around us. It's getting evil. The times are more evil. We need to rise and pray for our children. We need to rise and pray for this church, amen? Never let a day go by where you think, oh, it's okay. No, it is vital. It is vital. Our prayer life, it is vital and it's key. And tonight you may ask, well, what does even live above the reproach means? Well, I have the definition for you. It is the first legal word that indicates a kind of innocence in the eyes of the law. It means that no man can legitimately rebuke you or make any charges against you that will stick. They may accuse you, but say conduct will eventually acquit you by proving you blameless. That your life is so consistent, say consistent, ladies.
Consistent.
That your reputation is credible, say credible.
Credible.
That you are an example worth following. And you do not make the gospel look fake by teaching one thing and living another. Proverbs 22:1 reads, a good name is to be chosen rather than great riches, and favor is better than silver or gold. You do not have a good name at all unless your ethical integrity is intact and you live above the reproach. And that's the word of God. He already knew the mess that was going to go on. He already knew the pettiness that was going to lie before us. And that's why he placed these scriptures, these commands in front of us. Live above the reproach, ladies. Don't get involved in civilian affairs. Don't get caught up in the now. Amen? When I think of the word non-negotiable, I said this earlier this month. I think of the President Barack Obama. I don't know why it came to my mind. And he was doing a live press conference because I guess a couple of our citizens had went over to North Korea and they had gotten captured. And the terrorists were saying, you know, well, give us money and we'll release him. And the five words that came out of his mouth that ring through my head is, we do not negotiate with terrorists. And this is a principle that the government does not negotiate with terrorists. And it's been a long-standing American policy. Till this day, we still follow it. That was created by both parties. And the reason is obvious. You may think, why? Why wouldn't, you know, they negotiate to get the people back? Well, let me tell you why. Because when you reward an activity, you only encourage it for more. And if kidnapping our civilians and our diplomats seems profitable to our terrorists, you better believe that more are gonna occur. But as a US, they made a stand saying, oh no, We don't negotiate with terrorists. And we need to have that same policy in our lives, Christian women, mothers of this house, daughters of this house, leaders of this house, that we do not negotiate. We do not negotiate with the enemy. Because when you negotiate, ladies, it's not going to just happen one time. You better believe he's going to come back for more. When you slip and you have that hidden sin, oh, it's just going to keep happening and keep happening. And when you leave that back door open, he knows where to go through. He knows you left it open for him. But when you say, oh, no, I'm not going to do that no more. Oh, no, I don't negotiate. You close that back door. You're saying, I don't have a plan B. This is my only plan. And I'm a woman of this house, and I'm going to rise and say that the enemy is no longer welcome here, because I'm not negotiating my family, my calling, my ministry, my disciples, because I was lackadaisy, because I was complacent, because I didn't want to get up. We must get up, ladies. What we allow into our lives will only trickle down into our ministries, into our home, into our life groups, and into our families, and into our disciples. This past month, some of the leadership of this house, we had an opportunity to hear Sister Julie, and oh my goodness, when I see her, it just like, you're just like so excited inside, because it's like the vision right before you. And she's so personable. She's so, you know, so loving. She makes it so easy. You know, sometimes as leaders and women, we try to serve God and we make it so complex because we're trying to be this person that God didn't create you to be. He designed you, each and every one of you, with your own unique talents, your own unique voice, your own unique message. So use it, ladies. Stop trying to be someone else that God didn't create you to be. And what Sister Julie raised was an urgency that now is the time to get to work, that we must understand what the Lord is doing in this house. Victory Outreach San Diego, God has just promoted us. We are no longer just an ordinary church, but now we have elders. And do we understand that? Do you really understand that we have elders among us, and the authority, the honor, the respect that comes with that, but also the blessing that comes with that? As they rise, ladies, we rise with them. As they soar, ladies, we're soaring right there with them, amen? Because it starts with the top. And we have the best in this house, and we have to recognize that. Recognize that we're no just some little street corner church, amen? Trying to just, you know, bring in 5, 10, no, but we are expanding. We are the Vision Live. I believe that we are going to be a church of 500 leaders by the summer. By the summer, because the rate we're going with our bilingual services, I know that God is going to bring in the harvest. We're on this fast, and it's not just for no reason, but we're believing for souls. We're believing for the harvest for Easter time. We're preparing. We have a citywide campaign. We're occupying every street in San Diego. Do you believe it, ladies? In this room tonight, we all represent a family, a ministry, a co-worker, a legacy. And I don't know about you, but I want to be the best. The best for my family. Do you want to be the best for your family, ladies? Do you want to be the best for your ministry? I want us to reach our full potential in life, to see the people under us, to see our family, to see those around us blessed, not just us. How boring is that, that we walk around all blessed and everyone else around us is going through hell? Oh, that's ugly. I love to get reports that my disciples were blessed. I love to get reports from my family that these things happen to them and they don't understand how or why that the door has opened. Do you guys rejoice with that? Do you guys get victory with that, that those around you are getting a victorious spirit because you're on fire? I want to become a specialist in the area that God has placed me in. And I ask you that question tonight. Do you guys want to become a specialist? Or like Sister Anna was just saying, a manager just kind of oversees and delegates and, you know, just cruises. But we're builders here tonight. We know what hard work is. This church was not just a overnight success, but it came of years of being tested, of years of trials, but also years of blessing and blessing and blessing is still to come, amen? Amen. But we don't just blossom overnight. And in this generation, I feel like that. I feel like a lot of times everyone just wants to get rich quick. You know, like, oh, you know, I want to do this, and I have this plan, and da-da-da. You know, I'm making moves, I'm making money moves, all that stuff. But it's like, cool, but where's your hard work? What's your foundation? What's your purpose? What's your mission? You know, like Sister Anna's saying, you have to write it down before you. Success does not happen overnight, but it happens through victories, and it happens through our losses. And it's taking those moments of defeat and learning from it. If you don't learn from that mistake you made, if you don't learn from that one time that, oh, man, I messed up, it would have been for nothing. You would have went through all that hell for nothing, and you would have just been back on the same cycle. When I first moved out here, sorry. My whole goal in life was to be an FBI agent. Like my eighth grade yearbook, it says, what do you want to be when you grow up? And mine says an FBI agent. Like I legitimately wanted to be an agent. Like I wanted to work for the FBI. So when I moved out here, I started studying that criminal justice, you know, terrorism, like just really getting deep into it. I started took Spanish class, you know, I was trying to pick up French because you had to join the FBI, you have to know two languages. You have to hold a 4.0 GPA and your undergraduate. You have to take criminal justice classes, you have to be in fit, you know, in shape. So I was like trying to work out, run every day. You know, I'm gonna be an FBI agent. That's my whole goal in life, that's my purpose. And then I started to read what the academy entailed. And it's an 18-month academy. That's in Virginia, and you have no contact with your family. You can't go, oh, hey, it's Sunday, can I go to church? Nope, you can't, there's no church, no Bible study. You're completely cut off. All the extra luxuries, you know, going out or having fun or just even be able to go to church and worship God, that wasn't allowed because you had to be completely focused. And so I started to, you know, think about it, and I was just like, oh, I don't know if this is for me anymore, you know? God was starting to work in my life, and I was getting involved in the church, and I was just like, no, God didn't call me to be an FBI agent. And, you know, I love Law and Order. That's all I watch. You know, that's like my, you know, we all have that, like, secret thing we like. Like, we want to be Superwoman. We all have that. Like, we want to travel the world. Like, and mine is, like, I just want to, like, work for SBU. And so that's just, like, my little thing. But moral of the story was I saw how dedicated they were, but I also saw the risks, the pros and the cons, and their divorce rate is in the 70 percentile. They have no communication with family at any moment that they can be dropped into a mission and they have to go and defend the country. And I was like, no, that's not something I want to do. You know, that's not for me. But I say all this to say this, is that there's people out there who are willing to risk their lives for our country to protect us. But we don't even have women to rise up in this church that can say, you know what, I'm willing to risk my life. Pastor, send me to South Africa. I will go. Or do we have women like that in the house tonight? Are we so caught up in the luxury of Victory Outreach San Diego and the beautiful skyscraping downtown Little Italy, living life, missionary, you know, life? Or are we willing to lay our life down? And I had to ask that myself that question. You know, I don't want to just be a pastor's wife that comes and occupies a seat and that has a title. No, but I want to get to work for God's kingdom and build his kingdom and be reminded who he gave us. And that's the treasures out of darkness, ladies. Sometimes we get so caught up in building our family. I deserve this. I went up through the ministry. They don't know what I went up through the ministry too. I lived in the midtown too, and I'm grateful. I'm grateful, and I don't ride that carpet of my parents. I don't ride that carpet of saying, oh, you know, my parents laid the foundation church. Cool, but now it's your time to pick up your brick and help build this ministry, amen? Is this next generation with me? Because I feel it's really quiet in here, and it's a little scary. So now I understand what Pastor says when it's quiet. It's scary, you know? But I want our church, when he looks out, to say, Pastor, you can count on us. We're here. Whatever you want to do, we're backing you. We're here for you, Pastor. We're here for you, Sister Georgina. We are locked arms and hearts because we live above the reproach. We don't allow pettiness in the camp. We don't allow sin in the camp, amen, because we are women that have rise to the occasion, that we don't allow the non-negotiables. And earlier, Z, I was going to read the mission statement, but they read it. And it just reminded us of what our mission is about. Every agent, every specialist has a mission before them. And don't forget that, ladies. When you start getting weary, when you start feeling that burnt out season, when you start feeling like, I've been there, done that, I ran the women's home, I was admin, I wrote checks, you know, I did, thank you. Thank you. No, seriously, thank you for all the hard work you did. But when you start getting weary, pull out that mission statement. Pull it out and reread it and let that passion come back in you of why we do what we do, amen? And it's not time to throw in the towel. Sister Julie has not retired, and she is our founder. I don't know about you, but that convicts me when I'm like, oh, you know, like I'm tired. I just want to sleep in. It's okay. Rest. Yes, rest, but don't throw in the towel. Learn your strength. Learn your stride. It's not a race, ladies. We're in this together. We must nurture what God is doing in our lives, what God's doing in this church. We got to stay cutting edge. We got to stay fresh. We got to have that passion burning in us. And if you say, I don't know how to disciple. I'm brand new. I don't even know half of the things you're talking about. It's okay, because you are in the right house. That's what our leaders are here for. That's what we're being equipped for, ladies, is to show this next generation, is to show the harvest that's coming in, is what it is to be a first-class woman of God. Amen? And how do we do that? We live that with our lives. We disciple. We train. We walk with them. We do life with them. Paying attention to your personal growth is something we cannot neglect. Proverbs 25:28 reads, when you don't have self-control, you do what you feel. When we don't have self-control, ladies, we become an emotional woman. We become an emotional leader. And when we're like that, when we're up and down, you can't be counted on. I'm just telling you right now, we can't be counted on. We're free game from the enemy. I'm including myself. If I'm going to be an emotional woman, I can't be counted on, because I'm inconsistent. I'm up and I'm down. And I'm free game from the enemy, because my mind is all rapid. My mind's all loose. It's not covered. It doesn't have the helmet of salvation on, because I let my emotions take over. I don't want to be that woman. Do you? Do you guys want to be free game from the enemy? Like Pastor always says, what walks in us, ladies, what walks in our lives are going to run in our children and going to run in our disciples. And I just want to give you quickly 12 qualities that we should never negotiate as women of this house. And the first quality we should never negotiate is the spirit of faith. Willing to take steps of faith. Faith of a mustard seed. Faith that sees the hand of God move in this place. And I know we're on a 40-day fast, and if you haven't joined, it's barely the fourth day. You could still hop on. You could still join, because I believe with all my heart that we're walking in miracle territory. Do you guys believe that? That through this fast that things are going to begin to happen, that we're going to begin to expand our territory, our domain. We're going to become ownerships of this whole block. Do you believe it? Do you believe it? Does that inner man that you've been putting the flesh down? You know, we're not doing it for no reason. But on Easter Sunday, oh, I believe Easter Sunday is going to be Miracle Sunday. The same day that God arose, the things that were dead in our life are going to begin to arise. And number two is servanthood. We can never outserve. I love what Sister Anna was saying, that we don't just serve up and down, but we need to serve each other, ladies. We need to be relational women. We can't cut off each other. We can't have unforgiveness in the camp. We need each and every one of you. We all play a vital role. You're counted on here. You have a place here, ladies. You're wanted here. God wants you here. Don't let unforgiveness hinder what God's trying to do in your life. I challenge you, ladies, if you're not serving in a ministry tonight, I challenge you. Take that step of faith. Say, no longer am I just going to occupy a seat. No longer am I just going to be a mother in this house that just comes in and leaves and comes and gets fat spiritually and leaves. But no, I'm going to rise to the occasion. There's so many needs in our church, and God has given you those eyes to see it. I know you guys come in and you guys notice things. You guys may wonder among yourself, like, wonder why that's happening, or, oh, you know, this is going on and that. Don't wonder no more. Step up. God's given you those eyes to see it, amen? Integrity is number three. Who are you behind closed doors? Do you strive to be a woman of character? A woman who doesn't give up? Or is that only at church or only at work? But then when we come home to our family, it's all a mess. Our personal life, it's all a mess. It's all out of order. No, ladies, we need to be a woman of integrity. When people are around and people aren't around, we need to be women who could be counted on, that God can count on us, that she's a pure vessel. Yeah, she may not be perfect, but I know she's a woman of integrity. And if something's not right, she's going to stand up and walk away. Or she's going to stand up and say, oh, no. Oh, no, this is not what I do. And number four, she's a woman of conviction. I loved earlier the fashion show, you know, because a lot of us, we come in here and we don't know how to dress. We didn't have mothers to teach us. We're brand new. We don't have disciples. And I love that. There's so much modesty, ladies, that when you could walk into a church and you're dressed and you're clothed like that Proverbs 31 woman, so much respect follows it. Amen. This is the house of God. And when we come, we want to come and look our best. When we go to conventions or even when we're hitting the streets, it's not time to be sloppy. It's not time to dress like the world, but we need to stand out and say, hey, there's something different about her with her long dress, but it's okay. She's cute, but what's going on, you know? Even at work, you know, sometimes we're all modest and holy, and then at work it's like, oh my goodness. We got to be a woman of conviction. Woman that says, oh no, there's something not right here. I don't like it. I need to make a shift. I need to make a change in our actions, in our church attendance. That when we miss service, are we letting our leaders know? Are we letting people know what's going on? Like, hey, I'm facing a crisis. Can you pray for me? Or even saying, you know what? I don't feel like going. And sometimes I get those texts. I don't feel like coming. And you got to speak life into those people. You got to speak life back into them and have that open communication line that they can be honest with you, that they're not afraid or that they're not a lone ranger, that no one's checking in on them. Ladies, remember, we are the women of this house. We are the daughters of this house. God has given us these women. They're our responsibility, amen, in our thoughts. Conviction in a daily heart check. Are we checking our heart daily? Are we asking God, reveal yourself, Lord? Remove, chip away, God, those things that are not of you. You know, if we had a mirror in front of our heart, what would we see? Would we see black? Would we see division? Would we see compartments? Because that's how we try to put God in compartments. When God just needs to be first and everything will follow, amen? Yeah. Prayer life. Prayer life isn't just a ministry. It's just not on Pastor Victor and Sister Nikki and our pastors to pray for this church. But it's our responsibility to pray for your family, to pray for your unsaved loved one, to pray for those around you who you influence, for your home. Do you feel that responsibility, ladies? Do you feel it? Do you feel the responsibilities to rise to pray for our pastors? I remember there used to be a prayer service going on in the back, and sometimes it would be so loud, and Pastor Al would be preaching. Do we still have that? People intercessing for our church, for our pastors, for the word that's being brought forth. Do we have a specific group of women who can say, oh, you can count on me, Pastor Al and Sister Georgina, I have your back. Oh, there's a 24-hour prayer chain going on. Oh, we're fasting, and that we don't have to be told by our prayer pastors, but we feel it in us, a responsibility to rise, to cover this house, to cover our leaders. It's so vital. In a positive spirit, do we strive to be those positive encouragers? You know, the famous John Maxwell says, your attitude, ladies, is going to determine your altitude. If you're low in spirit, if you're always down, if you're that, no one's going to want to be around you. Plain and simple. If you're nagging your husband, he's going to want to run to the store all the time. He's going to want to go into the bedroom and watch TV. I'm just being real here. Can we be real here tonight? Let's have those positive spirits. Let's be those number one encouragers to our husbands. Let's be their number one fan, amen, to that ministry that you're a part of. Be the number one. It's like the best thing ever. To your disciples, encourage them. You're their mama. You're their sisters. They don't have anyone. They're relying on you to encourage them. They're relying on you to speak life into them, amen? Number seven, we can never negotiate our giving. This is our church's responsibility. God has given us specifically this church, and we're standing on debt-free soil. Doesn't it feel good? Because let me tell you why it feels good. Because like I said earlier, what happens from the top trickles down. So some of you next year are going to be up here saying, I am debt-free. I paid off my house. I paid off my school loans. No longer is this bill following me or that bill following me. And now I can give from my abundance and not even feel it. I can give and write checks off to help ministries because God has blessed me so much. Do you guys believe it? Do you guys have that faith, that giving faith saying, you can count on me. You can count on me that when we're ready to take this whole street, hey, I'm right there. Whatever you need, Pastor, you can count on me. Because I know where I came from. I know what I never used to have before, and I know what I have now. And I know that when I trust God with my first, with my family, but most importantly, our finances, and a lot of us were holding our purses tight, like, oh, what is she going to do? Is she going to, you know, I see you're holding your purse tight because it's close to you. I get it. You work hard for your money, ladies. But don't be that penny pincher woman. And then you're wondering why you're always penny pinching for your bills. Why you're always penny pinching to get to the end of the year. Ladies, let's love. Let's give liberally. Let's give of our time liberally. Let's not put limits. Yes, know your rest. Know your stride, like I said earlier. But also give. Don't give with, oh, 2 to 8. Let me know. If that doesn't work, sorry. No, 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 let's be open, let's be women. Because these are, we put on this, ladies. No one else is going to come in. Another ministry is not going to come in and put this on for us. It's our responsibilities. For Kids Gang, my goodness, how beautiful does Kids Gang look? And that was women's ministry. Ladies, if we can come together, what else can we do to make our church even more beautiful? For our people, more land that we can conquer, more events that we could do, more citywide evangelism that we could do because we're not limited. We have taken the cap off. Take the cap off, ladies. Take it off tonight. Spiritually, take it off. Say, no longer am I going to be held by the bills, by the stress, by the worry of this life. Yes, I'm going to be responsible in what I do. Yes, I'm going to make wise decisions, but I'm going to know that it starts with putting God first. And I'm a testimony of it. When we put God first, he will bless the rest. When we were challenged to do the 40-day fast, when we were challenged to do the 20%, when we were challenged to step out and give to this building pledge, oh, we didn't hesitate. We weren't trying to calculate in our head. We just gave. We gave liberally, and God met the rest. And let me tell you, if he could do it for us, we're nobody. We don't come from money. We work hard. We get up and work just the same as you. He could do it for you, ladies. You guys have that spirit in you. Let's break that poverty mentality spirit. Let's take the cap off of what we keep putting God in. We keep putting him in this cup. And we keep saying, okay, God, here's my tithe and here's my offering. And that's all I could give right now. Well, then that's all he could give back to you. Amen. We all want to be blessed. We all want to get rich overnight, but no one wants to go through the brokenness. No one wants to go through the process no more. No one wants to eat top ramen no more. Amen. When I was buying my house and come debt free, it's okay. I'm not ashamed. We ate corn dogs and top ramen. But hey, I could stand here and say that through God's grace, I'm a homeowner, that I'm debt free, that it was through God's grace that we put him first. And yeah, we had to cut back a little bit on the extra spending, but it's okay because God's bringing it. And God's going to bring the same abundance to you guys. Amen. Number 8, I'm almost done, is stewardship. Don't be an emotional leader. Don't be an emotional wife. Don't make life-altering decisions when you're under fire. Have that personal life in orders, ladies. God gave you that home. He gave you that marriage. He gave you that kids. I don't know how many times I could keep saying it. You got to take responsibility for it. Before you could become this leader, before you become anything, take care of that personal life. Keep things in order. Amen. We're atmosphere changers. We know the temperature of the room. We know when something's off in our house. Don't be so busy trying to move on and be busybodies that we're leaving our family behind. Amen. But no, we take them on the journey with us, ladies. Like Sister Gina said, we want to take them where we're at, where we're going. Don't leave your family behind. Keep that personal life in order. Number 9, love the Lord and desire to be in his perfect will, living it out loud every day, a life pleasing to God. Number 10, a transmitter. We need to be a transmitter of his word, of this vision, of the direction that's coming down from the top, having the house vision, knowing our mission statement. Amen. Do you guys know it? Do you guys internalize it? Do you guys see it when you're out on the street? Love the vision, number 11. Are we feeders to this ministry? Do we speak the vision? Do we have treasures out of darkness in mind? Or have we gotten so far away that we're like, oh, that's old VO 1967. We're new VO missionary, urban mission. No, ladies, we can never go back of what we were birthed in. And that is the treasures out of darkness, amen. That is the hurting people of this world, amen. That's the prostitutes, the drug addicts, the prisons, amen. That's who we are. And take pride in that. Take pride in that legacy, because that's the legacy I came from. And my family was turned around, and your family was turned around. And we're creating a new legacy, but we can't forget. We can't forget the promises that God gave us. And number 12 is my last point, is loyalty. It's so vital, ladies, to be loyal to God, number one, to our church, but to our families. I know that's not a word that's spoken among us a lot. Like, hey, how's your loyalty to your husband? Like, we don't just like randomly like talk about that. But it's such an important value in our ministry. It should be an important value in your life, that I value my marriage. I value my children. But most importantly, I value God. I value my church, my leaders, and all that's been entrusted to me. I don't take it lightly. I don't minimize it. When the times get tough, ladies, and it will get tough, because we do go through tough seasons, I tell you, don't collapse, don't relapse, but learn your stride. Open up to leaders around you. Be honest. Ask for help. Leaders, it's okay if we don't have it all together all the time. It's okay if we're a little overwhelmed, and let another leader know. That's what we're here for. We're a team. We're a team ministry. We're a team church. There's no I in team. Judges 5:7 says, a village life ceased. It ceased in Israel until I, Deborah, arose a mother in Israel. And this scripture tells us that the people got complacent. Village life ceased. That means nothing was going on. That there was such a heavy oppression that they were just stuck. They were stuck in their situation. Oh, but a woman arose named Deborah. And she said, I arose a mother in Israel. And she was declaring, I'm taking responsibility for my city. I'm taking back what the enemy tried to steal. I'm casting out those demons that have tried to oppress my family, that have tried to oppress my disciples, those among me. She was taking responsibility back. We are the mothers and daughters of this house. We need to take a stand at the front lines. Not at the back. We need to be the frontline warriors, women, that we could be counted on. We need to be like Jael. She was waiting for the enemy. She wasn't caught off guard. She knew who the enemy was. She knew who the target was, because she was focused. Her mind wasn't everywhere else, but she knew. Yes, she was taking care of her home life, and it was in order, but she was also taking care of God's kingdom. She was taking care of business. She didn't need to go and call her neighbor and say, hey, the enemy's coming. Come kill him. No, she took care of it herself because she was focused. She arose. And yes, you may feel like, well, you know what? All I just have is my family. Build that family. Build it in this house. We need you. We need strong families in this house. We need examples to rise. Amen? More families to come into this church and fill it. Fill it with the children who run downstairs that have examples. Many of us come in from broken homes, don't even know what it is to see a good marriage. But God's restoring all that. He's bringing it all back. He's bringing it all back. Amen? We are all in this together as a team. To win our city for Jesus, we need to close that back door, ladies. We need to close that plan B, saying, I don't know if this is for me. You know, one thing I learned in my walk with God is I can't play dodgeball with the process. I can't come in and out and think I'm going to be effective. I can't come in and out and say, hey, I'm ready. What do you mean you're ready, girl? You were just out of it, and now you're ready? No. If you get tired, if you get weary, know it. Speak up. Let others refresh you, but don't give up. I know many of us, we have health challenges. You know, we may have family challenges. You say, it's so easy to talk up there because you don't know what I'm going through. I may not know personally, but the women who stand up here, the men and the pastors who occupy the seat, they have been through some things, amen? This church has been tested. This church has been tried, amen? And I believe that we need to rise as women of this house and not suffer alone. I know many of you, you may suffer in silence because you feel like no one understands, or maybe you feel like I'm going to be judged. You're not going to be judged. Let's get that out of the room right now. No. No, we need to be open. We need to take care of business. We need to cut that disease that we have been carrying. And we need to let life back into us. We need to let breakthrough back into us. We need to believe for miracles to happen, to get on the fast, amen, to believe for our families. We need to rise. We must get up, ladies. We must get up and take back what the enemy has tried to steal. It's our time. Can you say that? It's our time. It's our time. Do you believe that? It's our time as we stand this morning, this evening. You are the mothers and the daughters and the leaders of this house. Don't minimize that. Don't try to put it in a little compartment and say, on Sundays, I'm only the daughter of this house, and on Wednesdays. But no, I pray that every day when you wake, that that presence goes with you, that that non-negotiables go with you, that when you're out there driving around or you're out there picking up your kids and you see the need in front of you or you see something that's not right, you will arise. The devil will arise in you. The devil will say, oh, no, 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 not in my house, not in my church. This is my church. I have work too hard for the enemy to come in. Amen? We need to be those women of this house. Proverbs 31:30 reads, charm is deceptive and beauty is fleeting, but a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Honor her for all that her hands have done, and let her works be praises at the city gates. I don't know about you guys, but I want to be a woman that brings honor, and I believe you do too. I believe you really got to take that and say, I want to bring honor. You may have done some things in your past that you're walking around with shame. You're walking around with embarrassment. Maybe a leader, you feel like, I messed up. I've been counted out. No, tonight, I'm calling you. I'm calling you. We need you. We need you in this army. We need you, women. We need you, daughters. We need you to rise and take your place. San Diego needs you. Victory Outreach San Diego needs you. Let's just not occupy the seats no more. Let's take responsibility of all that God has given us. And I just want to, if you guys want to come up here and say, I don't want to just say yes with my lips. I don't want to just do lip service, but I want to say yes with my life. I want to give my family over to you, God. My personal life, God, only you know what's going on. I want to give that sickness over to you. I've been carrying it too long. I've been trying to hold it in too long. That unforgiveness, I've been trying to carry